So good morning everyone. So welcome back to my channel. This is Jomer Adams once again, and I'm very excited to learn with you once again. So again, I just want to welcome everyone back, and I hope that you will be enjoying our opportunity and our time to learn today. So let's dig into our topic, which is very much timely and very important in our generation today. So we are gonna talk about your human immunodeficiency virus, also known as your HIV, and it is very important because as medical technologists, as medical practitioners, most probably this would be one of the most common disease that we will be encountering in our practice. So let's dig into our human immunodeficiency virus right away. So, a quick history. Let's go back to the past. Let's go back to the past and learn all about your HIV. So, the first sign of HIV pandemic actually began in 1989 with an official report of a cluster of cases of pneumonia due to pneumocystis carinii, or your pneumocystis jirovecii. It is in previously healthy young homosexual men in Los Angeles. So I don't know if you already have watched a lot of documentary or a lot of movies actually with regards to the rise, with regards to the pandemic of HIV that happened in 1980s. So most of the time, most of these patients actually appear to have a cluster of pneumonia, and when they actually tested the specimens of the patient, they actually have linked it all to your pneumocystis carinii or your pneumocystis jirovecii. And at the time, they thought that it was just simply your pneumocystis, it's just a pneumonia. But not until similar cases had been reported, but on a much larger cluster of cases, now not only showing your pneumonia but also with Kaposi sarcoma, also in young homosexuals. And that had been an alarm not only to the public but also, of course, to our health sectors. So during this time, they actually observed that most of this patient doesn't only have your pneumonia but they also are showing symptoms of Kaposi sarcoma. So during this time, they actually had much of the investigation, and they found out that common characteristic among them was a severe and a generalized immune deficiency. So that is one thing that they actually have a hint of already. As you can see, all patients that actually are mostly young homosexual men, they actually observe that not only does they have pneumonia, but they also have Kaposi sarcoma. And eventually, they found out that all of these patients are also immunosuppressed or are immunodeficient. So, as you can see, that is the appearance of a Kaposi sarcoma. So, not until Francois Barré-Sinossi and Luc Montagnier isolated a sample from a patient in 1983 that was also taken from a male homosexual, that they actually was not unprecedented. They actually would found out the causative agent or the underlying cause of these diseases. Of course, we know that Kaposi sarcoma is caused by your herpes, your pneumonia is already caused by your pneumocystis carinii, but they actually know it at the time. They actually are hypothesizing that this must be something bigger than those virus and bacteria causing it. So at the time, with the identification of the virus, reagents were soon developed. So it was these two great scientists who discovered your human immunodeficiency virus, and during that time, they know that they have to work fast, similarly to what is happening right now in our case, now that we have your ECQ because of the pandemic coronavirus. So during that time, after the identification of the virus, reagents were immediately developed. So they have to develop reagents that would identify, that would actually help in the diagnostic processes. And eventually, with the reagent, it was proven that earliest case of infection by HIV-1 came from a person in Central Africa in 1959. And imagine that, it was around 1980s when they found it out. And most of the patients that are actually showing pneumonia and even your kaposis or coma are already patients with advanced stage of not just HIV but of AIDS. So during that time, they also was able to identify, in the case of the 1980s pandemic, they were actually able to identify that it was your human immunodeficiency virus 2 that was identified in those patients. So roughly, we actually have two strains. We have your HIV-1 and we also have your HIV-2. One that was actually found out in Central Africa, and the second one, your HIV-2, was the one that caused pandemic in the States during the 1980s. So HIV now is recognized as a zoonotic disease that entered the human population from chimpanzee. So this might have been another spillover from animals now going to humans. So it was believed that this HIV, the virus, actually came from a population of chimpanzees, and these viruses are somehow related to the group of more than 40 simian immunodeficiency virus, or your SIV. So similar to what they actually found out in your chimpanzee, they actually saw that most of those cases are actually similar to your SIV. So that is what do they believe the ancestor of your HIV. So meanwhile, after that, there are four distinct lineage of your HIV-1 sequence that has been identified. So there are different your HIV have two serotypes. You have your HIV-1 and you have your HIV-2, and HIV-1 could actually be further classified into M, N, O, and P. So the group M is the predominant lineage of HIV worldwide. And detailed study on the sequence of HIV showed that groups M and N were actually derived from the simian immunodeficiency virus that was found in chimpanzee. So during this time, most probably that maybe you're wondering how that it was transferred, since it is somehow sexually transmitted in some sort of other transmission, like vertical transmission, which obviously cannot happen to chimpanzee passing it to human. But if you're gonna look at it deeper, it actually has to do something about bestiality practices during that time as well. So afterwards, we also have your groups O and P that were derived also from an SIV found in the western lowland gorilla. So if the M and O, M and N are actually found on your SIV on the chimpanzee, your O and P are actually from your gorilla. So HIV-2 is derived also from your SIV. So aside from that, your HIV-2 and HIV-1 are somehow all related to those animals. So the transfer of HIV-1 group M lineage occurred in or near Kinshasa in the Democratic Republic of Congo around 1920. So it was believed that even around 1920s, the HIV was already passed on to humans from the animals. So it in Kinshasa, Congo, Republic of Congo. So HIV, for the information of everybody, HIV is actually a member of the genus called lentivirus, or the lentiviridae, and both of them, HIV-1 and 2, are both member of that genus. So they are from the family of retroviridae. So when we say retroviridae, they do have RNA. Their main genetic material is your RNA. That's why your retrovirus can insert its RNA genome to the host cell via reverse transcription. And eventually, as we go along, I'll be mentioning three major enzymes used by our HIV for it to be able to thrive within the host cell. And more specifically, what type of cells do they infect? Because they are very much specific about that. So, common features of lentivirus infection includes infection of the bone marrow-derived cells, integration of the DNA copy of the viral genome into the host DNA. And again, if we're gonna go back to our discussion about coronavirus before, as you can see, almost all of our viruses cannot produce its own genetic material. They cannot produce their own genetic material. That's why they have to hijack the host cell's DNA machinery for it to work on their favor. So they are also characterized by persistent viremia, and of course of lifelong infections, prolonged subclinical infections, weak neutralizing antibody responses, again due to immunosuppression, and continuous virus mutation and antigenic shift. All right. And aside from that, it is also included neuropathology on your lentiviruses. So this is actually your HIV. As you can see, your HIV is an example of an envelope virus. It has an envelope. And as you can see, it has a capsid, a nucleocapsid. The nucleocapsid containing now your very important viral RNA genome for it to replicate. And at this time, I just want to mention three major enzymes that your HIV uses for it to be able to hijack your host cell's DNA machinery. We have here your protease, we have here your integrase, and of course the infamous reverse transcriptase. So as you can see, these three enzymes are very important. But aside from that, maybe you're wondering, how does the HIV knows what particular cell will it infect? And to be honest, it's actually so genius that it actually is targeting one of the major immunoregulatory cell within our body, and that is your CD4 positive cell, also known as your T helper cell. So how does it knows that? How does it identify the CD4? First, it has actually two glycoproteins. So we have your glycoprotein 41, which is a transmembrane protein. As you can see, it protrudes from the envelope outward, where you can see your glycoprotein 120, which is a docking glycoprotein. And in general, together, glycoprotein 120 and glycoprotein 41 is glycoprotein 160. All right. So much about that. Let's move on. So the structural proteins of your HIV are glycoprotein 120, which is the one that binds to the CD4 receptor. So it's similar to a lock and key method. So a particular key is only specific for a particular lock. And that is how genius the HIV was, that its key is only specific to the receptor found on your CD4 cells. Aside from that, you also have your glycoprotein 41, which is a transmembrane protein that mediates the virus membrane fusion with the host cell. So these two glycoproteins are very important because upon the binding of glycoprotein 120 in the CD4 receptor, the envelope of the virus needs to fuse now with the envelope of the host cell, eventually entering the host cell. So that is the job now of your GP41. And when it comes to the HIV replication, so now we know that it is GP120 that attaches to the CD4 receptor. It is your GP41, okay? It is your GP41 that mediates the fusion of your viral membrane and your host membrane. Now we go to the HIV replication, the 7 stages of your HIV life cycle. So the first one is binding, and this is the job now of your glycoprotein 120. After binding of your glycoprotein 120 to the CD4 receptor, it will now start the fusion, and this is now the job of your glycoprotein 41, a transmembrane protein that initiates the fusion of the viral membrane and the host membrane. After that, it will now be liberating the genetic material alongside with the 3 major enzymes that I mentioned a while back, your reverse transcriptase, your protease, and your integrase. What happens next is that the RNA is now liberated within the cell, and it first need to form its complementary DNA with the help, of course, of your reverse transcriptase. So reverse transcription happens whereby the RNA makes a copy of your a single strand complementary DNA. And as you can see, if you're gonna look back in the central dogma, that's not how it happened within the body. First one, you have your DNA, and then it will be undergoing transcription for it to become your RNA. But for the case of our viruses, it's not the same. They have the RNA, and they will reverse transcription it into becoming a complementary DNA. And afterwards, what happens? So in the reverse transcription, it is the reverse transcriptase that does the work, that takes care of everything. When it comes to integration, I wonder if you can guess what enzyme it is. Okay, yes, correct, it's your integrase. In the integration, what happens now is that, isn't it, after the reverse transcription, you already have now the viral DNA after reverse transcription, and that viral DNA needs to be integrated within the host DNA, and that will now be the job of your integrase. It will integrate the viral DNA into the host DNA so that when transcription happens and when translation happens, it's not just the host cell or the host protein that will be produced, but also your viral proteins and viral genetic material. After that, there will be replication. The viral DNA now will start to be replicated, to be duplicated, and afterwards, after transcription and after translation, okay, we have now your proteins and also your RNA that was produced after your processes. And that is the time now where the HIV is ready to assemble. Yes, it's similar to your Avengers, they also would assemble, and that is now the job of your protease. It will now start to trim some proteins that are needed and are not needed, and afterwards, after the assembly, they will now start to bud off using the cell membrane of your host cell, and then they will now be free on your bloodstream and then go and infect another CD4 cell, or worse, go and infect another person. And that's what's happening. And let's go to each and every step. I actually have given you the wrapped up already. But in the binding, it's also known as your attachment. So the HIV binds to your receptor on the surface of your CD4 cell. And that is your CD4 receptor. Again, this is the job of your glycoprotein 120. And at the same time, right after that, there will be a fusion of your HIV and your CD4 cell membrane with the help now of your glycoprotein what? Correct, your glycoprotein 41. So afterward, reverse transcription happens. HIV releases your reverse transcriptase, converting now your HIV RNA to its complementary HIV DNA. This allows now the HIV to enter the CD4 cell nucleus and combines with the cell genetic material. So as you can see, your nucleus, it has your nuclear pore where your materials or the viral genetic material could enter. And what happens next is your integration. Correct. The integration is done by your integrase, whereby it integrates the viral DNA to the host DNA, eventually following the replication, whereby the HIV uses the machinery of your CD4 cell to make long chains of HIV protein. And afterwards, when protein is fixed, protein is all present,
we can now start to assemble. So the HIV protein and HIV RNA move to the surface of the cell and assemble into an immature HIV. We say it's immature because it doesn't have its own membrane yet. But right after budding, the immature HIV pushes itself outside the CD4 cell and voila, it's now liberated. So the process of budding, the release of protease breaks the long protein chain to form the immature virus. Then smaller protein will combine to form now your mature HIV. And this is how it looks like, okay? This I hope you can see my cursor because I will start to do some pointing. So this is your HIV. As you can see, it's the job is in your CD4 receptor and your CCR5 or your CCR4 coreceptor both bind to your GP120. The fusion will be initiated by your GP41 all throughout to the reverse transcription, to the integration, to the transcription, to the assembly, and eventually to the budding off of your HIV. So that is how it happens. I hope it is very clear. So I want you to follow through the arrows here. Malay nyo, this would be the question in your homework. So please do familiarize yourself when it comes to the HIV replication or the life cycle of your HIV. Okay, moving on now. We also have here your HIV replication. So this is just the reiteration of what I mentioned a while back. From budding, from fusion, from reverse transcription, to the integration, to the assembly, and eventually to the budding off of your HIV. All right. So there are actually stages of HIV infection. The first one is the acute HIV infection, the clinical latency, and eventually when it progressed now to your acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. So I want you to be familiar with what is HIV, what is AIDS, what is COVID-19, because that is very important. All right? So for the stages of HIV, we have your acute HIV infection, and it is characterized within 2 to 4 weeks after infection. People may actually experience a flu-like illness that may last for weeks. So, to be honest, I've talked to other people, and most of them actually have experienced this really after a contact with a particular person. They would start to develop flu-like symptoms, which actually is very much negligible at the time because they would actually thought that it was just a common flu and nothing serious about it. But apparently that's the early stages or the acute stages of your HIV infection. Afterwards comes now your clinical latency, or also known as the asymptomatic HIV or chronic infection. This happens when HIV is still active but produces at a very low level. Okay? At the end of this stage, the viral load goes up and the CD4 count goes down. Obviously, the CD4 goes down because this is the main cell that is being targeted by your virus. So here, you can actually won't see any infections or any symptoms at yet, but the moment that the HIV is now active, the HIV now, the viral load goes up, the CD4 count now would start to drop and leaving the patient immunocompromised. And afterwards, when the patient is already immunocompromised, it will now be progressed and will be diagnosed as acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. And this is the more severe stage of HIV infection because of a badly damaged immune system. It increases the number of opportunistic illnesses and eventually causing now your Kaposi's sarcoma, your oral thrush, and even tuberculosis. And maybe you're wondering, sir, why does the HIV causes now your immunosuppression? So let's go back to the role of your CD4 cells. And this is not part of the PowerPoint, so I just want you to take down notes and listen to this. So your CD4 positive cells, also known as your T helper cells, is actually the main signaling cell within your immune system. So whenever there is an opportunistic pathogen that comes inside your body, it is the job of your T helper cell to signal, to call all immunological cells and eventually even release some cytokines, some interleukins that will be needed for the production of antibodies and for the production of an immune response to combat that virus. And if it happens that the one that actually signals the entire system is missing, it went missing, it was already depleted, there will be no signaling cell within your body saying that, hey, we have an infection, we have to be heightened. And that's the time now where opportunistic illnesses comes inside your body unknowingly and leaving now your immune system vulnerable and compromised. That's what happened. Okay, so how does your HIV is being transmitted from one person to another? So we already know that it originated from chimpanzees, from gorilla, and eventually it was actually passed among humans already. And usually one of the main causes is unprotected sexual intercourse, sharing of needles, so some of the intravenous drugs that was very infamous during that time. We also have blood transfusion. Reason why, during blood transfusion, we actually have major bloodborne diseases that are being detected. One of those are your HIV. You also have your hepatitis B, your syphilis, or your syphilis or your treponema. And then we also have your malaria. Some also are including your HCV, and in some cases they are also including CMV as well. Organ transplant is also one, mother to baby during pregnancy, because the virus can cross the placenta. And eventually, not only can it cross the placenta, you know that there is a maternal fetal connection when it comes to the blood supply. So the CD4 can even go to the baby. That is, in number 5, we also call it vertical transmission. So talking about now about the different transmission, as you can see, the increase of HIV cases, not only here in our country but worldwide, is starting to really be so alarming. So the HIV cases here in the Philippines actually starts to increase and increase and increase each year. As you can see, from 2017 to 2018 to 2019, the records continue to increase. One of the main reason probably is that more people are getting tested compared before. That's one. So awareness is actually being awareness is already a friend to us. But then, okay, the more alarming case is that more of these cases are actually teenagers as young as 15 and even younger than 15, which is somehow very alarming, to be honest. And when it comes to the HIV cases, as you can see, most of the transmission, so I am giving you a graph of the distribution of how HIV is transmitted. So only 1% are actually due to blood transfusion. Thank God, because we have an effective blood bank system here in the Philippines. 3% are from needle sharing, because IV drugs is not that very famous here in our country. So they actually use to sniff rather than inject themselves with drugs. Aside from that, we also have drug to mother to child. We also have here now our sexual intercourse. And as you can see, much of the percentage actually came from your sexual intercourse. And if we're gonna break down that, 11% of that is actually from heterosexual sex, so male-female sex. 21% actually are sex with both male and female among males. So this is very alarming as well. But the chunk of the graph actually lies with male-to-male sex only. So for the homosexual, even in the 1980s, it started to increase in the homosexual men community, around 58%. That now leads us in a proportion of report death among people with HIV by transmission is that more people, actually, as you can see, comparing our data from the January 1984 to September 2019, as you can see, there has been an increasing cases of deaths among HIV patients because of the transmission due to male-to-male sex. So 63%, imagine that. That's really big. So it's very important we are talking about. So one of the reason why I am mentioning that the increase in the cases are because of increasing awareness and increasing testing capacity of our country. So testing for HIV should be voluntary, which is another story for another time. If you wanna check on that, we have a video on that. That is RA8504. We have 3-part video regarding your HIV and regarding the law that concerns our fellow men with HIV. Aside from that, the testing is also 2 phases, okay? We actually have 2 phases of HIV testing. That is actually 1 for the screening and 1 for the confirmatory testing. So, aside from that, we also have HIV counseling, both pre-counseling and post-counseling. We also have to have an HIV testing facility with HIV profession. And of course, I just want to emphasize something. So HIV counseling is different from HIV testing. So medical technologists are mostly the one that are HIV proficient, the one that can perform the test. And for HIV counseling, these are from nurses, from psychometrician to physician, and even medical technologists as well. So they do the counseling pre and post testing. So I think we're coming to an end. So laboratory diagnosis are usually the identification of your HIV-1, 2, either antibody or antigen using an immunoassay. So the confirmatory test is your Western blood. Maybe you came across with RIVDA, but RIVDA is just an algorithm, a rapid HIV diagnostic algorithm. So again, if you want to go into that deeper, you can actually visit another video that is your RA8504. Please do watch it so that you will have a deeper understanding of this lesson. Aside from that, you also have your nucleic acid test or your nucleic acid amplification test that actually removes, or actually there is no need for a window period phase anymore. So most of the time, this actually have contributed to the low level of HIV transmission in blood samples, because they actually use NAT tests to check HIV in blood bag units. Okay, so this is actually the rapid on your left. That is actually a screening test. As you can see, we have here a control line and a test line. So if there is 2 lines, that is positive, similar to your pregnancy kit. But if you have 1 line, but be sure that the one line that remains is your control line, that is negative or non-reactive without HIV. If 1 line is present but it is off the test line and none of the control line, that is invalid. And if none of the line appeared, that is considered what? That is considered invalid. So moving to your right, that is actually your Western blot. Western blot is actually your confirmatory test. And for us to be able to consider it a reactive or a positive result, there should be at least 2 bands coming from your either GP120, GP160, your GP41, or your P or your core protein 24. So remember that. Okay, remember that. So if you have a band that is actually 120, 41, that is already positive, at least 2 of those 3, okay? Either of those combination, but at least 2 bands. Okay, but right now we don't have any treatment or vaccines against your virus that can effectively kill it. But what we have is actually an antiretroviral drug. It actually targets some of the key function or the key mechanisms on how the patient is being infected. We have your CCR5, which is a receptor of your CD4. We have also post-attachment inhibitors. We have fusion inhibitors inhibiting your GP41. We also have your non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitor. Aside from that, we also have another reverse transcriptase inhibitor. We have your integrase inhibitor and protease inhibitor. In a nutshell, what I'm trying to say is that most of the drugs are actually targeting either your cell receptor, your glycoprotein, or the enzymes that are key in the transmission of the disease. Are we clear? Okay. So much about that. Thank you so much for keeping up with me. So if you have any questions, clarifications, comments, so please comment down below on my YouTube channel. And if you have some things that you want to ask privately, you can email me. You can send me an email at jaganding@toa.edu.ph. So that would be all for today. This is Jomer Adams once again. So please do like, share, and subscribe this video. And please do subscribe so that you will be updated for the latest posting in my channel. So I'll leave you with this saying, strive so tomorrow you can thrive. Thank you so much and have a great day. Good night, good day, good afternoon, whatever. Have a great day. See you soon.